It was Valentine's Day 35 years ago. And I was playing with a folk band called Straubs in Hemel Hempstead, I think. And at the same time, the world's loudest rock band were setting up their amps and speakers in a rather small and intimate refectory at Leeds University. When they started playing, the noise was like a sledgehammer. This was the start of air guitar, wasn't it? Try to put us down by my generation. Oh, just because we're talking about my generation. Say, you look awful. Talking about my generation. I die before I get old. The fans who were there at the time didn't realise it, but they had become part of rock history, immortalised in what is widely regarded as one of the finest live albums ever recorded, The Who Live at Leeds. Why don't you all
fade away? From the first chord from Townsend, the place was rocking. It was a sellout, as you would expect, because The Who was such a big band at that time. It was probably the beginning of the age of rock.
And yes, that is Roger Daltrey, a man who doesn't give interviews to anyone. But we got him.
It was like four complete and utter, you know, alpha males. Totally miles too much testosterone. flying around the stage with the booze for fuel and all other kinds of substances as far as Keith was concerned. It was a very dangerous area to be in. No one controlled any of it, and I think that was what the magic was. It was dangerous. It was really dangerous.
Now, whilst you're all sitting there saying, God, he looks good for his age, I need to point something out here.
I mean, for a four-piece, made a lot of noise, didn't it?
There are bound to be a few problems when two deaf old rock musicians try and have a sensible chat.
Where'd the name come from?
What, Leeds? Haven't a clue, mate.
Right, I'm not going to get anything sensible out of him for a while, so here's a few rock facts. Back in 1970, The Who had just conquered the States. A follow-up to the rock opera Tommy was needed. It had to be a no-nonsense live album.
The band had already recorded 80 hours of their sell-out USA tour, but when they got back to England, they couldn't be bothered to go through the tapes.
Pete came into the studio and see how I was getting on. He said, how are they then, Bob? I said, they're good. He said, they're all great. He said, what about your notes? I said, what notes? I said, they're all great. You haven't made any notes. He said, burn the lot.
We just had hundreds and hundreds of tapes.
They still exist?
Probably Pete's got them somewhere. He says he burnt them, but I don't think he did.
We did burn them, except maybe a couple survived. He said, let's figure out and record a couple of concerts.
So they hired the Pye Mobile, which is a big tape recorder in a van, and parked it up a Leeds side street. Quite amazing it was still there when they came out, when you think about it. I'm a substitute for another
guy. I'm looking pretty tall, but my heels are high. So Leeds University refectory was turned into The Who's recording studio. 2,000 piled into the dining hall, another 1,000 listened on the roof. The students that were there remember it well. Bang!
Straight away, and it's bang for the length of the concert.
Who superfan Rob Everest?
If you had a time machine, a lot of people would choose to go there, to that concert. It was difficult, after seeing The Who, to enjoy other groups. One went to see them, but that extra bit of excitement was missing.
Back then, a runner, now an anaesthetist, still a Who fan.
Just astonishing. One of the best concerts I've ever seen. What you saw was what you get, which was four angry young men absolutely at the top of their game. This was very special. Special staging, very good sound, tremendous atmosphere, big crowd, everything came together. The buckskin jacket and the microphone throwing and this thing. That's what rock singers should be doing.
Now, remember in 1970, this was the look.
I don't know what they're on that night, but all the audience wanted to go on it as well. Townsend played himself to death and ran about, kicked his feet up in the air. It was just a physical assault on your eyes and your ears. Just fantastic.
They also recorded the next concert just in case Live at Leeds didn't work out, in which case the world-famous album would have been called Live at Hull. The next show was at Cleethorpes.
We did Hull the following day, and Hull was a better show. To be really honest, from what I remember of Hull, it was a better show than Leeds. It sounded better and it was tighter because it was a theatre.
Right.
So the acoustics were better.
So how did it end up as Live at Hull?
They didn't record the bass.
So we just threw our hands in the air and sort of said, well, let's go for Leeds. Which in a way is kind of stopped that problem of what I was saying about earlier. Well, maybe that was a bit better. No, that might be a bit, no choice, you know, which I think is much better.
No disrespect. We all change over the years. Then a 17-year-old schoolboy, Chris McCourt, was employed by the band's management to take photos for the album cover.
You paid?
I was paid 50 quid.
Were you really? That's pretty good for those times.
I was really pleased.
So you went up and you did the photos. They didn't use any on the album, did they?
No, when the album came out a few months later, I went to the shop and looked at it and pretty disappointed that none were used.
Now remember, Roger hasn't met Chris the photographer since the gig in Leeds 35 years ago.
That's you then.
That's me then.
Oh, I remember you.
Yeah.
Are you serious?
And for 35 years, these photos have remained Chris's hidden secret. Until now.
It was one of those records that infuriated your parents. They just thought it was noise. And that made it all the better. See me. Feel me.
Touch me. I remember that. What else you got on here? Where's Young Man Blues? Well, you know, in the old days. That's enough of that room. It goes to say that a lot of the longevity of the 60s bands are because they played to that whole generation of university students.
I was standing in the gents, and this bloke with a big nose came in and turned out it was Pete Townsend.
And it's the greatest time of their life. It's the last time of their life. They were really free.
It was just incredible.
They were listening to all this great music and they remember it. And every time they hear it now, it takes them back there.
It's so loud.
I really do think that's a lot of the key to the success of bands like us.